Okay, we're on our way to breakfast in the elevators. Here we go. Okay, down on the main level, we're gonna go put the itinerary up on the board. It's gonna be a great day. We're following the footprints of St. Paul today and the early martyrs in the catacombs. So here's where the day begins for everybody with a nice breakfast. There we are. Good morning.
Good morning.
And did you remember to pray for your grandfather yesterday?
I prayed for you at St. John's tomb.
At Mass.
St. John Paul's tomb.
You guys are having a good time together, aren't you?
Yep.
Morning.
Good morning.
Waiting for the bus. We're on our way to Tre Fontane, which is the place where St. Paul was martyred. Outside the walls of the city of Rome, they brought him out here and they cut off his head. We're going to commemorate that now. We've now arrived at one of my top favorite places in Rome, the place out called Tre Fontane, Three Fountains, where St. Paul was martyred. This says right here, the road of the martyrdom of St. Paul. We're now going to walk up this road that St. Paul walked up before his head was cut off. Paul actually walked up this road where we just walked, and he walked on these stones, original from the Roman road and the Roman Empire. And then we're going to go into the church, and this is the place where Paul was martyred.
They ended up moving back to Jerusalem, and there he was trained under Gamaliel, the great Jewish rabbi that even today they refer to as Rabban, our rabbi. And he was trained there, the best and the brightest of the young students at the feet of the best and brightest of the rabbis. And then after he grew up, probably 20 or so years old, he was a Pharisee, and he was trying to clean Israel up and get rid of the heretics and those who were against the temple, and to bring people back to the temple. And there's a young man named Stephen, and Stephen was with this new group called Christians, those who followed Christ. And he was one of those who went out preaching and doing miracles, and they had to stop him because they were pulling people out of the temple and following this new, they called him Messiah, this Jesus from Nazareth. And can anything good come from Nazareth? He's just a carpenter. How can this be anybody special? So they get Stephen and they bring him to the courts, and they end up taking him out and stoning him. And do you remember what Stephen did right before he died?
Had a vision.
That's the first began of the vision, and that's what made everybody so angry. He said, I see him standing seated at the right hand of God. It comes right out of Daniel chapter 7 about the future Messiah. And so it said that they ripped their robes and they ran at him and they took him out and they stoned him. And Saul of Tarsus was there at the stoning, and it says that he did two things. He was holding the cloaks of those who stoned him. The way you stone someone is to push them off a cliff in a quarry, and then he took a big rock from up above and threw it down on him, and then everybody would take off their cloaks and they would finish the job with rocks. And Saul of Tarsus was holding the cloaks, and it said he was giving his approval for the execution, almost as though he was a representative of the Sanhedrin there to give the legal representation and approval for this execution for blasphemy. So after that, it's significant that Saint Stephen prayed and said, forgive them, and prayed for his executioners. Because when we later get to the church of the bones of Saint Paul, I'm sorry, where we're going to be at his bones at the next church, there's a chapel there to Saint Stephen. And I remember thinking, why is there a chapel to Saint Stephen right next to the bones of Saint Paul? And then I remembered that he had prayed for him, and I looked it up, and Augustine had one time said, if it were not for the prayers of Saint Stephen, the church would not have Saint Paul. Mm-hmm. So then Paul gets converted in Damascus, and he goes all over the world. He goes as far as all over Roman Empire. He even goes down to Mount Sinai, because that's the whole thing that's in the book of Galatians. He goes down to Mount Sinai. 14 years he's studying, preparing, getting ready, and then God calls him in Acts 13 in Antioch, where we were first called Christians. Acts chapter 11, 26, we were first called Christians, Gentiles who follow the Jewish Messiah. That's what the word Christian means. Christos is the Greek word for Messiah. So when you say you're a Christian, you're a follower of Christos, you are a follower of the Jewish Messiah. And we were first called Christians, and the Gentiles were. Paul went out on all these missionary journeys, and after his third missionary journey, he came back to Jerusalem, and he was arrested, and he appealed to Caesar, and they said, to Caesar you shall go. So they took him to Rome, and he was in prison, house arrest for 2 years. He got out in about 62 or so, and he had 5 years more freedom. He went back to Corinth and Ephesus. He went all the way to Spain, and he came back, and while he was in Ephesus, he was arrested again, brought back to Rome. Him, St. Paul, and Peter were both put in the Mamertine prison, which you remember, we were there. We didn't go in, but we saw it. And they were in Mamertine prison. Remember, I talked about the rats and the mice with their little yellow teeth nipping at their flesh, and their urine and excrement and a terrible ending. And Janet, where's my iPhone? I just want to read a passage. Sorry.
For a short time before he was actually executed, Paul was put in this little prison under the Church of the Stairway to Heaven here in the same grounds, and then taken out and executed. We're coming through the holy doors of St. Paul's. Hello. Thank you for volunteering. Thank you. Good morning. Buongiorno. And this is our last of six holy doors. Last of six holy doors that we've gone through here in Assisi in Rome. And we enter into what was once the biggest church of the world before St. Peter's. Look at that. Welcome to the tomb of St. Paul. One of the things I love about this church, besides the fact that St. Paul's bones are right down there, which I'll show you in a minute, is the medallions of the popes. They start out with Peter, Linus, Cletus, Clement. They go all the way around the church, all the way. You can see there's all 266 popes. There they all are. And it ends now with Pope Francis right there. On top of that, they have the life of St. Paul. Follow the whole life of St. Paul through these paintings. There's a book of them that are very nice, but that is the whole life of St. Paul in art. And then the special place, of course, and what this is all about at this church is under the high altar is the tomb of St. Paul, where his bones are kept in the sarcophagus right in there. And those are the chains that bound Peter when he was in Rome. The chains of St. Peter. The chains of St. Paul right there. And the sarcophagus where he's buried. Liz is such a great guide in Rome that everybody wanted to give her a hug and have a picture with her and say goodbye. So this is just a few of the shots that we got. After Mass, we went to one of our favorite restaurants for an outdoor lunch.
Say it again.
Look at the turtles.
There's six of them. 1, 2, 3, 4.
So we always try to find some things to entertain the kids on a trip too.
Yeah.
Parker and Ariel have found the turtles at lunch. Oh, and there's some fish.
Yeah, there's tons. And my mom used to have fish that would just walk over the bridge and poop and fall
out. Under the vines outside on the Via Appia, the ancient Appian Way. All the wine you can drink and fresh cold water on a warm day.
You can't beat this restaurant, Cecilia Metella, for environment, ambiance, food, and wine. We always love to bring our groups here. It is just a great place to eat. And then we go to the catacombs. We are entering the catacombs of Saint Sebastian. We go down underground and for about a half an hour tour the catacombs, seeing the place where the early Christians were buried. They did not call it the burials or the necropolis, a city of the dead, like the Romans did. But the Christians call it a cemetery, a sleeping place, and they deposited people there because what happens when you make a deposit? You come back to take a withdrawal. That's exactly what they thought about the resurrection. One of my favorite things in the catacombs is the graffiti, which we're going to see right now, where the early Christians scratched Peter and Paul, pray for us.
To talk with the Pope for a few minutes. And Steve brought Crossing the Tiber, and he had a whole speech prepared, and the Pope is coming down the line, and a few people away from Steve starts bawling and doesn't get a word out of his mouth, if you can believe it. But I was down on my knees. Holy Father, I want to raise up a priest for the Lord. Will you please pray for me? And he had his hands all over my face and my head and my shoulders, and he's praying for me. And
tomorrow is a free day, so we had a meeting back at the hotel where everybody came and got ideas of all the things they wanted to do on their free day. And we gave them ideas, helped them with maps and so on. And it's been a great day today, and everyone's excited about tomorrow, so join us again then.